Trigger warning. This podcast contains descriptions of various abusive situations. Listener discretion is advised.
The court adjudicated several of these children to be abused and neglected.
Mark Maples is the county prosecutor.
The judge ruled that based on the testimony from child after child from this witness stand, that the punishment a majority of these children had received by the Bethel leadership amounted to cruel, extreme, unreasonable, and disgraceful punishment.
You are listening to the Preacher Boys Podcast, a podcast shedding light on decades of mental, physical, and sexual abuse within the independent fundamental Baptist movement. The testimonies shared on this podcast are told from the personal experience and perspective of the survivors. Not all legal outcomes are known or final. Any suspect is presumed innocent until proven guilty in the court of law. To find more information about the Preacher Boys podcast and upcoming documentary, visit PreacherBoysDoc.com or connect on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter with the handle at PreacherBoysDoc. Now, here is your host, Eric Skwarzynski.
Welcome back to another episode of the Preacher Boys podcast. I'm so excited to bring Alan Knoll on the show. We were able to connect in person over at the protest in Provo. I got to introduce myself and get to hear him present his story a little bit. And I've just heard so many good things about you, Alan. And I just want to kind of get an introduction of who you are for our audience who isn't familiar with you and just kind of let them know how you got introduced to the IFB through way of the troubled teen industry.
I was sent away when I was 10 years old. I was a hyperactive kid, but I don't really know why I was sent away. And I was sent to, both programs that I went to from the age of 10 to 15 were, IFBs. And that's how my life got turned upside down, is being sent away to these two programs. And
What was your life like prior to that? I mean, 10's super young. I mean, you're not even in the teenage years yet. What was your life circumstances to where it was decided that you would be sent to Bethel, to Bethel Boys Home back at that early age?
Yeah, my life's always been chaos. I grew up in a broken home. My mom had been married and remarried multiple times before I was 8. I'd been through, trauma in my life, physical and sexual abuse. So I didn't have any stability. I was, and I'd throw temper tantrums, those kind of things. It was too much from my mother married into money, the last one, and I was too much for him. And so they made the decision to send me off. But, I don't think there's ever been a point in my life, at least my childhood life, that wasn't chaos or disruptive.
When you initially arrived at Bethel, did it feel going from kind of chaos to, I mean, seemingly instantly there'd be a lot of extreme structure, did it feel like a positive thing at first? Did it feel like an escape from kind of the chaos, or was it instantly one chaotic moment to another?
I always liked church when I was a kid. It was a way to get attention that I wasn't getting at home. I like to go there and sing. And that's how my mother sold it to me. Nobody was religious in my family. It was just, I like to go to church. I like to get the attention. I've always been that way. Some say now, even. But right. It was my way to keep myself, out of my home. So I always liked church. And so she's like, we're sending you away. It's going to be like a Christian camp. Okay. Right. And, it was just supposed to be for a couple months. And, it was really my thing. And that was the selling point that my mom used to try and convince me that, this is going to be fun and not what it ended up turning out to be.
Right.
Both homes I was taken, Bethel, I was by my mother, and to Agape by my first stepdad. And it's pretty common that people will be transported by bounty hunters or be tricked sometimes by other family members. I knew where I was going. So I had that, at least. I didn't get taken in the middle of the night. And I'm thankful that I didn't have that added to my trauma, as many survivors have to deal with the trauma of just that aspect alone. But, going there, it was not, it's chaos. You're away from your home. It wasn't as violent. Bethel wasn't as violent at the start. 2 months, it was still violent. You're still getting hit with sticks and those kind of things, and really structured. And so, you know, during you're quiet, you're shy while you're in a place that you're, you know, and I'm from Seattle and I got sent to Mississippi. So these people talk funny. The weather's weird. There's these giant bugs and snakes. And so I'm 10 and that's just how I was. I was a 10-year-old more fascinated in the change of scenery than I was, you know, having an understanding of what was about to take place in my life.
Yeah. Now I remember you saying that at Provo. I remember that there's one thing you mentioned noticing was just like, even the accents of everybody was different. And, you know, you kind of cushioned that statement because you didn't want to come across offensive at all. But like, I think what you speak to is kind of the culture shock. You know, it's going from at 10, you know, your immediate surroundings and you have a very vague idea of the outside world. And so to be thrust into it and told to just act as if everything's normal is got to be a pretty strange situation to find yourself in. So
when you're 10, it's not just the staff or the structure. You're also dealing with a bunch of older teenagers that, you know, have anger and those kind of things. I was the rat. I was the little boy that was annoying, you know, so I had both sides of it.
Right. What was the age range from at Bethel? I kind of know Agape, which we'll get into, but with Bethel, was it about the same? Was it like everywhere from 10 to 18? Was it a pretty broad group of people?
Later, they lowered their age quite a bit. But when I was there, there was three people. I was the youngest, Sammy and Lucas, and that was it. That was under 13. Okay. Everybody else was generally 14, 15, 16, 17 years old. And so later they would, you know, change their criteria to get more population, those kind of things. But sure. I was definitely one of few young ones, excuse me.
Right. Was there any separation how you were treated based on age, or were you kind of just expected to fall in line with everyone else regardless of age?
So I talk about this when I tell my story or in the book is, yes. So for me, there was, because it's hard. We're still, I mean, as sadistic as some of these people were, they still have that human, you know, kids are cute, you know, there's still that semblance. And so I was treated differently than others my early months there. And I could go hang out with the family. I didn't get involved with all the discipline aspect of things. I later found out that they were trying to adopt me and my mother had told them no. And then I had this, you know, where things were cool. Bethel was okay. It was not that bad. Besides being away from home, my brothers, my family. And then, you know, I didn't know I just knew that one day everything changed for me. I was thrown in and I was still 10. I was thrown in with everybody else. I was treated an outcast by the family. I'd made friends with his kids and his wife. And so I was thrown into this thing as if I'd done something wrong. Nobody ever told me anything. I was being punished like everybody else, as if I was 16 or 17 years old, the exact same.
Hmm. So what was, you know, you talk about kind of the general treatment, what was the day-to-day there? I mean, obviously when you first got there, it seems like it was very different, but when you were kind of in the, you know, for lack of a better term, general population of it and were treated as an equal, what was a day in the life of a Bethel student?
Well, it was early. So a day, so there's, Bethel's divided. So, and I was there for both terms. So I'll just start, I'm just going to pretend like it wasn't divided. So Bethel was a divided, you know, at first it was bad, but not that bad, compared to what we would soon deal with. So during those times that, you know, our day-to-day lives was quite a bit different than what happened when William Knott arrived. So I can answer both if you'd like.
Yeah. Yeah. I'd be curious to know first perspective when you still kind of have the lens of like, oh, this is just a good church so camp to go to at first.
Yeah. So when I got to Bethel, the day-to-day life was, you know, get up at 5 a.m, go down, eat chow. They'd usually put us to school pretty early so that they could get us to work by about 10 or 11 a.m. So we'd go spend about 2 or 3 hours in church or in school, excuse me. And Bethel at that point it was all about, you know, they would contract us out to the pecan farms or to the, you know, Air Force base to do work there or, building houses on the property and they would sell the houses. And so that's the most that I remember of that time. I was also really young. The trauma was still, you know, like I got caught cheating and, you know, they make you go pick a stick, right? I was cheating on my paces and the guy's name's Bubba. you know, and he's Herman Fountain's son that ran the school. And he's this good 350-pound dude. I mean, just big old fat guy. And I remember, like, you're going to hit me with that thing? Like, I'm the size of your arm, right? And so it was structured abuse, you know, besides all the, you know, but it was still abuse, but it wasn't nearly of what I was about to deal with. And so at the day-to-day life is we would do work. We'd do school. We'd do work. We'd do our chores in the dorm. We'd eat. We'd clean our uniforms, those kind of things, get ready for the night. And that was just every day. And then, you know, obviously we have church. We'd have a chapel every night and then church three times a week throughout. And then when William Knott got there, things, I mean, literally we were asleep when he got there. He got there early in the morning and he just turned on the lights. He was with Herman Fountain. And it was a from that point on, it never stopped ever. And he was literally, I mean, it's just some black guy that comes in that nobody knows. And he's yelling at everybody and counting down. He's like 20, 19. I want you in formation outside. We don't, you know, nobody knows this guy. Right. And so, and he says, you know, that he's going to throw, if you're not out there, he's going to throw, throw whoever's not outside off the balcony. Right. And one person didn't, and he did. And that's how it started with William Knott. We were literally asleep to chaos, and it was chaos all the way through. I mean, this guy was sadistic. He's sitting in a prison cell now. And as you know, by doing this, these guys are really slippery. So when you go to prison, you've done some bad stuff.
Another story breaking right now. Three people convicted of child abuse at a residential youth home were sentenced this morning. Pastor John Young, William Knott, and Alicia Moffitt all sentenced to 20 years in prison for each count of aggravated child abuse. The three ran Saving Youth Academy. The guilty verdicts were handed down last month. Some teen victims testified they were abused and locked inside rooms for several days at a time.
I mean, he would sick dogs on us. I was essentially waterboarded, where they make you exercise, and then they would make me lay on my back and they would put a foot on my chest, and they'd have 3 5-gallon buckets of water,
right?
And they would pour it over my face. And so, I mean, and that's, those are my stories, but I don't want to get too much in the weeds. I'll let you kind of ask your questions, but that never stopped. And then the program went where school didn't matter. It was just work and discipline.
Right. So really the shift came with the hiring of William Knott then.
Yes.
What was his background? Like, where did he come from before that? Was it something where he was already working with homes like this? Was he just some random friend of the family's that took on the job? Like, what was kind of his background there?
Yeah. So, and I'll give you a little bit of both. You'll get two backgrounds. So William Knott was a former Marine, and he was kicked out of the Army or the Marine Corps. And, a few years before I had gotten to Bethel, the state raided the home and took the children, took all 73 kids out of the home. And Herman Fountain punched a cop in the process. He went to prison for assault on a police officer for 1 year.
The court adjudicated several of these children to be abused and neglected.
Mark Maples is the county prosecutor.
The judge ruled that based on the testimony from child after child from this witness stand, that the punishment a majority of these children had received by the Bethel leadership amounted to cruel, extreme, unreasonable, and disgraceful punishment.
He met William Knott in prison, and he got out before Knott did. And so that, you know, that's, he would get staff members that had nowhere else to go because he would control them, those kind of things. And so that's how Knott got, he never had any experience that I know of being in programs. And he, Fountain would bring in people all the time that he'd met in prison. And you know, nobody stayed around as long as Knott did. But that's kind of how Knott got there, and was through their acquaintance in prison.
Well, I mean, it's stunning that even with a background where he had done prison time, that he was still able to operate a home. I mean, just setting that aside, the fact that that was still okay for him to do that.
Or that the reason he went to prison is because they already had come in to take, say, you're abusing these kids, we're taking them out. And then to still, forget the assault, he'd been shut down, they pulled the kids. And then to still just get out and start it up like nothing happened. And he did it 4 times. He's still running a program today. But right. he moved on to adults, vulnerable adults rather than children.
Right. What was kind of, I mean, so you said there were like 70 plus kids, like 75 plus kids at the home before it was shut down. How many kids were there during his return and like the time that you were all there?
Yeah. So when I got there, he was, you know, prison obviously lost everything. And I got there pretty close after he got out of prison. They were poor and there was only about 40 kids when I got there. So there's about 40 or so. And, you know, he had to reestablish himself. And so it was a pretty small school at the time. And by the time I left, I think it was over 100, 110 students. It was also how the program was when I got there was pretty lax. We had clothes, like we had to wear our church clothes but we still had our clothes that we brought with us. And, you know, things were pretty, I mean, besides working and having to deal with the bullies of the fountains, it wasn't that bad and not changed. I mean, every structure, how we folded our clothes, how we organized our lockers, I mean, every aspect. And so Herman and the fountains, I like to call it pre-knot. That's what we call it, you know, amongst the survivors is, you know, night and day on how it was. I think that's why they brought Knot in, is to say, hey, we're going to make this a boot camp. We can mark up our price a few thousand dollars. You'll provide the discipline to keep the kids from revolting. And this is going to be great. And they went with it.
And that's when you guys switched to like the uniforms and everything like that, right? I mean, that was when that shift kind of happened.
Yeah, we started wearing camouflage BDUs and boots. And then we still had our dickies for church and school. Hmm. No more clothes, no more nothing. Before Knot got there, we could get like a commissary where Herman Fountain's wife would go out and we could like make a list, right? Like we want combos, soda, some top ramen. That was all gone. There was no more access to the outside world and definitely no treats of any kind.
Right. Well, I definitely do want to kind of circle back more on the day-to-day stuff as far as like the, you know, I mean, obviously there's two or three people that are in prison, right? Based on their affiliation.
Yeah. So they took three out of Restoration Youth Academy. And I didn't know the other two. I only knew William Knot. He was, okay. You know, he was the, you know, the guy that went and got it done after Bethel was closed officially. He moved state over to Alabama. Started the program up. So the other two, I don't know. The Fountains have managed to escape for now. They've been managed to escape the law, but we'll see.
Yeah. Well, I'll definitely circle back on some of that, but I am curious, you know, you obviously weren't a part of like the IFB movement up until this point. You had gone to church, you know, on and off. I mean, would it be correct to say like, kind of like a lot of Americans are Christian in the sense of, you know, occasionally you find yourself inside of a church with family, or was your family religious at all prior to this?
None. My family, I would walk to the church. It was the way to kind of get rid of me on Sunday. And that's kind of how it was introduced to me. Why don't you go to church? They'll sing songs. And then I met people there and they were nice. And so I liked that part of it. It was a safe, you know, I was kidnapped when I was a little baby. Right. So, yeah. I mean, my whole life was chaos. That was my little safe place.
Right. Did you consider yourself religious when you started attending, or was it more, you didn't really identify with the faith aspect, more the just location? You appreciate the location.
Yeah. As much as any 10-year-old understands.
Right. Right.
You know, and that's really, you know, it's like, I know I didn't get sent there because of doing bad stuff. Like, you know, a lot of kids do. A lot of kids make poor choices and they end up, you know, the parents say, hey, we're going to straighten you out. You know, attend, you know, whether it's religion or knowing the difference between right and wrong is pretty, you know, narrow.
Yeah. Right. I asked that to just say, I know like in places like this, they really pounded the, like you said, there was, you know, a lot of preaching, a lot of services. And unfortunately, while there is physical trauma, mental trauma, there's also a lot of spiritual trauma that happens as a result of these places. And, you know, that all ties in with the mental trauma as well. So I was just curious, you know, as a 10-year-old growing up over the next couple of years and kind of those most formative times, you know, what role or how did you accept the messaging of the school? And did you feel like it gave you a, what was the role of the religious side? I mean, for you personally, while you were in the home?
Yeah, obviously, you know, I went in there thinking that, you know, my parents had sold me as this being a camp. And I did like church. I Fountain is an incredible speaker and preacher. He knows not to be long-winded. He knows how to keep the attention of the crowd. The songs were always fun. So that part of it, and even with the discipline, I could deal with it. It sucked, but my life wasn't too much better at home either. So, so I bought into it a little bit. You know, I would sing, and try and please, obviously, but I didn't really know. I could barely read the Bible as an adult and understand what's going on.
Sure.
But after Not got there, I watched them get wealthy off of us. I watched how their tactics of manipulation. I was always a smart kid. And same with Agape, you know, we'll get to that later, but especially with Agape, you know, I was older there and I really had an understanding. I would listen and do the things that I needed to get by, most of the time. I won't step foot in a church, and it's a shame.
Yeah.
But I won't go to a church. It's like walking into the enemy's territory, I guess.
Sure. I know that, obviously you've covered quite a bit of this in your book, Surviving Bethel, which I'll definitely include a link to so people can check that out. So I don't want to spend too much time rehashing everything you have in there, because I definitely want people to check it out. And then I do want to talk more about the advocacy side, but just to give a picture, I know you mentioned when he first arrived, but can you just kind of walk through like I know we mentioned day to day, but like what were some of the physical abuses? Because there was a lot. I mean, Bethel, even more so than some of the stories I've heard from Agape, Bethel was extremely physical in their punishments or abuses. Can you just kind of run through like the attitude of the staff and like what life was like kind of being under that environment?
Yeah. So Bethel was, not only were they brutal, but they would, they did a 2020 interview and they're showing these bruised and bloodied kids and on live television. Yeah. I don't see a problem with it. It's none of the state's business. So they were openly, defiant and saying, I'm not doing anything wrong here. It's what my God tells me I can do with children.
Right.
Spare the rod, spoil the child. And that's just the creative, how they would create punishments were just insane. Once Not got there, generally before Not got there, it was just, like you'd get licks, you know, getting hit with a stick. Right.
Yeah.
And you would have like stupid things like digging a ditch from one end of the property to the other, those kind of things, push-ups, calisthenics. When Not got there, it was extreme physical, just like the military. You're doing up downs and push-ups and all these things. And that's how he ran it. If one person messed up, we all messed up. But he would come up with these just insane ways of like, I never even thought about it till this conversation, whether like he was just sitting in prison thinking of these things, but he would say Yano Shmidi. He had two pit bulls, Diamond and Polo, and Polo stayed on my bed. That dog loved me. But if he said but he was scared of him. And so if he said Yando Shmidi, I'm running like the devil. Right. And so very common for people to be, and he did it and he would just laugh, right. As kids are trying to get away from the dogs, they're jumping top bunk to top bunk to top bunk. And the dog climbs up on the locker and he's doing the same thing. And they're just laughing. Right. I mean, that's how crazy this is. But they would do things, you know, we had a pond, we had a swimming pool. So, you know, he would make you tread water. He would just sit there and he'd have his Diet Coke with him and he would just sit there and 7-8 hours with a giant stick. So anybody that tried to touch in the pool, he'd hit him with a stick, right? And then in the pond, he would just keep them out deep enough where they can't touch. So, and then, you know, there's times where people would go under and they would give them mouth to mouth. And speaking of that, there was a story, one of the guys that we work with, he's here locally in Seattle, Franco, he was drowned in a dish sink. And I remember that day distinctly, because they had these, rolls out and they hadn't been cooked. So it was real yeasty and you know how they swell up. And I remember watching them hold him down in the water. And I think I was 11 at this point. And it was just overwhelming to me. And I just took this pan of freaking rolls outside and I was just throwing them in the tree because it was all sticky. But they would, you know, so they would do the drown and resuscitation. They would do the cattle prods. I mean, they would come up digging stumps out with a spoon, and you cannot come into the dorm or go to bed until you're so Winky, or Steve Davidson, everybody at the facility called him Winky, but he had to dig an entire stump, you know, out with a spoon. And he was out there for weeks and slept outside and everything, was not allowed in the dorm. So they would come up with these little things. Or they would, if they wanted to beat us, they wouldn't do it. I mean, Fountain always was hands-on, and I mean, they would do it, but it was more like throwing you around, not would punch people. Fountain would slap people so it wouldn't leave marks. Fountain already knew, he'd been through this. And so Fountain's thing, not would generally deal with you yourself, but was to turn us against each other. When kids would come in and they had an attitude, and that's, he would reward people for, you know, messing up these kids, you know. And so they would, I mean, I could talk forever about the discipline forms and the crazy things, but they had this ability. I mean, whether it's standing on the wall with a locker, and these aren't lockers, these are made of solid wood, and they're about 2 feet tall by 3.5 feet long, and it's a good 60 pounds. And you're doing squats with them, and then every time you know, he always had a stick or something with him, or, you know, if he really didn't like you, he'd just beat you. So yeah, it was pretty brutal, man. And this is the most I've talked about it since I've written the book in detail. I don't like talking about it. I just wrote the book and quit talking about it.
Okay. And then, so you ended up getting shuffled to Agape. So did your parents just find another? No.
I left Bethel in 99. And no, I fought Bethel. So I can tell you the story if you want to know it. But I left Bethel because I was kicked out of Bethel and stayed with Agape.
Got it. And what led to you being kicked out of Bethel?
Yeah, sure. So at Bethel, I had about had enough. I was getting older. I was dealing with the kids. You know, I was always the runt. You know, you can see the pictures. I could send them over. But I was a little runt, and I was mouthy. I was always mouthy. I'm still am sharp witted. And so I was tired of it. I was tired of, you know, worried about getting attacked in my sleep by the kids. I was tired of dealing with the staff. And what had happened, the catalyst is it was a couple things. I had gotten punched in the eye, by a staff member. My eye was completely out. Not like the eyeball, but swollen out. And so I said, screw this. So I broke into their office. I called 911 and the sheriff's come down and I see them from the dorm going down to the house. I'm like, all right, cool. So I go down there and the sheriff's in there talking to the Fountain. And, you know, he'd come out to ask me what happened, goes back in the house with the owner and then comes back out and goes, well, you won't get smart next time, will you? Got in his car and left. So I'm like, man, he's emboldening these guys. I'm going to die here. I'm going to die here. And that's really how I felt. CPS had left us twice. These kids would run away. I mean, and they knew, but they would leave us. And I just don't understand and never did understand why.
Well, CPS, well, I mean, because of the religious exemptions, I mean, CPS had very little say. I mean, right?
Well, so, and that's just it, is the thing is, it's just like the Agape is doing yesterday and today, is these are troubled kids. They're lying. You know, he got in a fight with one of the other kids, you know, or whatever. I don't know what the conversation was with, because they went into the house and I don't know how they explained that. But when CPS came, they were right quick to pick me because I was the littlest, right? And they pulled out a tape recorder and I said, I'm not telling you nothing unless you get me out of here. And they told me that we're going to take care of you. And I told them everything. And they not only told the Fountains that, I told them all that, but they left me. And that was really the end of any standing I had there, with, you know, not being beaten because of my size. Right. And, there was that. And then they started a girls home. So all this happened really quickly, and started a girls home, and I'm, you know, 13. So they put me, I was probably 12, almost 13. And they put me next to the girls while they were waiting for the girls' school to be built. When we were in school, well, I'm passing notes to the girls. Well, anyway, somehow the owner got a hold of the notes, and I got called down to the house, and he had a razor strap in his hand, and he beat me for, I don't know, probably 5 minutes straight with a razor strap on the porch. And then, you know, normally he when he would do stuff like that or punish you like that, they'd say, all right, and they'd talk to you so you're not upset. And they try and get you to where you're not going to, like, run away to cause them more problems. And so he did that, and he goes, now go on, boy, go back to the dorm. And I just said, no. And that's what went on for the next 2 months. They beat the shit out of me. To the point where I didn't care. I didn't want to live anymore. If that was going to be my life, I didn't want to live. But I certainly am not going to comply with them. And so this went on for, I don't know, for about 2 weeks. They tried everything. They tried to turn the kids against me and punish them because I wouldn't do the exercises. I wouldn't do their whatever they wanted me to do. And so it was everybody else getting screwed up. And so anyway, that's how it went is, but then they were worried. They had to leave me alone. Finally, they couldn't do the resources. The difference between Agape and Bethel is there was like five staff versus Bethel or Agape where there's, you know, 30 or 40 of them. So they had to keep control of the kids. And that's why I left Bethel is they were worried about the influence I had on, hey, wait a minute. He's got something here because they can't beat you forever. And so, they told me, well, your mom's going to take you to Agape. Off I went.
Right. What was the shift like going to Agape? I know I've heard you mention, you know, Agape was much, much less intense than Bethel, but what was kind of the shift there? And, you know, were you relieved to be there at first again? Did it feel like, again, I'm getting away from kind of this insanity, or did it feel like you were from one frying pan into the fire kind of situation?
No, I was pissed off, is to put it lightly. So when I left Bethel, I didn't go straight to Agape. I went home and I was home. And then my dad took me to Agape from home, and I didn't get the opportunity to, like, you know, that's what they always says is you're too rambunctious. You chase your brother with a stick one time. Anyway, I was mad. I was real mad. So Agape, I actually didn't think that, you know, I felt like I was going to the same place. I don't know. That's my only experience in my life is that they're all like, so I was terrified. And I went in there, you know, partly rebellious, but also trying, you're uncomfortable.
Thank you for taking this campus tour of Agape Boarding School. Agape was founded April 1st, 1990, began in Stockton, California. My brother and Mrs. Jim Clemenson, they started the school in their home, but it soon outgrew that home. Agape is a school with a heart in the heart of Missouri.
I had my problems for quite some time. I was on the buddy system for about double what normal people are, which is the system where they do shirts at Agape. You know, yellow's for the newbies or people that don't want to listen. So I stayed yellow shirt for a long time. But and Agape, you know, I like to put this in perspective. Agape was no doubt, I've been elbowed, swatted with a paddle, not a stick, but a paddle multiple times, restrained, I don't know, 30 or 40 times at Agape. And, you know, where they're twisting my arms and that kind of stuff. And it's bad. It's terrible. And, you know, Agape has a lot more of the structure and, you know, no contact, same kind of concept as a lot of these programs do. And so but it's just when you're living in fear of death, and it's not that, it's just, I can't take away what I lived. I can't say, hey, this was still, but in my head, I'm like, this is cool. I'm good. And it's not, the only reason is because what do I have to compare it to, right? And so I make a point that when I talk about it, that Agape absolutely was bad. But from a 10-year-old who had never experienced life and had just gone through that to there, in my head, I've never been able to shake that feeling of, it's okay, right? I shouldn't. But the comparison is, I mean, night and day. And so I'll let you go ahead. And I'm rambling a little bit.
No, you're fine. I mean, that's kind of the weird part of the situation is that you went from incredibly abusive to abusive, but less so. And, you know, in comparison, one of those things seems better than the other. But like you said, you're at that point, all you knew was bad. So it was like, what version of bad is preferred? So I mean, I've had a couple people on that have talked through like all the punishment systems at Agape and the shirts and everything like that. But just from your perspective during the time period that you were there, which would have been what years? This would have been.
So I was at Agape from 99 through 2001.
Okay. So during that.
I left after 9/11, about a week after.
So you would have been 15 when you left then in 2001.
Yeah. Okay.
So during that time period, the early 2000s, you know, was it as regimented as, say, you know, what I've heard, you know, into the, like the later 2000s where, you know, because it seems like it's gone through a lot of waves as far as like being truly horrific, awful to, you know, being very bad, but less so to, you know, I just spoke with someone earlier today who said, you know, for about a 3-month period, it was like pretty normal. And then it got, you know, pretty rough again. Like, what, during your time, like what was kind of the day-to-day at Agape in like those early 2000s, late 90s?
Yeah, I'll dive right in. And really, experience is based on how you behaved at Agape. There's people that could get through there without ever having an issue. And I know that, like, but they're still dealing with the mental side of it, but they could get through there without any physical, if they could keep their head down and be quiet. And I'm not that guy ever, but, but Agape was very much more structured than Bethel. I mean, Bethel had like the, but they, it was more, you know, it was all work. I mean, the religion was a ploy for them, but, and, you know, and probably for Agape, but they made it like this point. So at Agape, it was religion. Just driven down our throats 9 ways to Sunday. So they had that, you know, you wake up in the morning, you get dressed, you go upstairs, you read your Bible for 30 minutes, you go out and haul rocks, whether it's negative 10 or 110, at about 6 a.m., 6:30. And you haul rocks back and forth. Usually during the week, it's just rocks that they have you do. So you go out there for 30, 45 minutes and move rock piles from one spot. Sometimes they're frozen together. You got to break them apart. But, and they would do that. And then on the weekends, you're doing like real work. Unless you're on a crew, like building their buildings and stuff, then you wouldn't go to school. You'd help. Like if you had a skill or like big enough to like be a laborer, then they'd let you skip school to go help build the buildings. So Agape was, you'd haul the rocks. You'd come back in, you'd eat breakfast. Agape had a thing like you always ate the food on your plate. You didn't eat the food on your plate, and which they gave you these incredible servings, just huge servings when I was there. And there was like this little kid named Bradley. I think he was like 9 at Agape, and the kid could never eat his food. And so he's always, you don't get another meal until you finish that meal. So there's a saran wrap, and that's your meal for breakfast if it's dinner, right? And so they have those little things, games that they played. So then you... eat breakfast, you go down, you get dressed, you go to school. And Agape, actually, we went to school at Agape, much more so than Bethel. And you know, they had the testing. They actually had a school, whereas Bethel was just, here's your pace, do it. And so they had a school and they had some teachers. And then you would leave school and you generally get about 30 minutes to 45 minutes free time. And by free time, everything's monitored. For those that are listening, that, you know, when we say free time, it's structured free time. And so, and then you go down, you change, or you go down, you wash up for dinner, you go down to the dorms, and you come back for dinner, you go down, you change your clothes, you go to a chapel, you go back, you shower, and you do it every single day. It became monotonous for me. And, you know, super religious to the point where you have chapel every single night, like a full on chapel service, not 20 minutes, but a full on chapel service. You're talking hymns, you're talking everything. There were, you know, and in order to pass your tests, you had to memorize scripture. So you can know the subject that you're doing with. So you know your geometry, but you failed because you didn't remember Timothy 1:3, right? You know, or whatever. And so they were really big about that. Mandatory to read your Bible. They catch you looking away from your Bible. You're on the wall. You know, and I remember just sitting there every day. I just stare at a blank page for 30 minutes. You know, so that's Agape was like that. And then, you know, there's always staff members that would come in that would shake things up a little bit. You know, Brian Clemenson, who runs it now, he came in a few times. And, you know, he started some different programs within the program. And he was always very physical with us, as well as even Scott in his younger years was always real physical with us. And so we had that physical element there, no doubt. If you talk back, you're getting popped. You're getting, so Brian has this thing about his elbow, and I'm sure you've heard this, you've talked to other people.
The Jurassic elbow thing.
Yeah, yep. Yeah. And so you talk back, you're going to be cleaning yourself up. And so he had that, and he was one of the more brutal guys, which is funny to me because they say, oh, we don't do that anymore, but that guy's not changing. If you can do that to kids, you're sick. So anyway, I'll let you kind of guide me back together.
No, sure.
I'm tired, dude. I'm so sorry.
You're good. You've been, you're good. You've been crazy busy. And like everyone who is on the advocacy side of the troubled teen world, there's been a massive amount of attention on it lately. So all the people who I'm sure weren't returning calls are probably blowing up your phone for interviews and things like that, and trying to reach out. So totally fine. I want to push kind of that direction. I'm with Agape. You ended up leaving, like you said, around 9/11. What was the reason for which you left? Did the school end up take you out? Was it your parents were just like, oh, we'll call in? Or what was kind of the reason your time came to an end there?
So my time at Agape ended less violently as my time at Bethel, but pretty close. I had watched Agape had burned down right before I got there. So they didn't have anything. We were doing, school and church in a gazebo hut in the middle of winter. So they didn't have anything. And I watched them. They always preach that they don't do this for money. It's always for us. They don't do this for money. It's always for us. But I watched them. I watched them have little beater cars when I got there. And then they're driving Lincolns and they're buying exotic animals. And I'm, getting older where I understand I'm learning the psychology of people, right?
Right.
And I'm learning how these people manipulate us and how they do things, right? And so I watched. And so anyway, there was a couple incidents at Agape that triggered me, just like at Bethel. One of them is they would do Sundays. If you did merits, like got merits, you could hand in these notes, or you can hand in the merits and they'd bring in burgers. Well, I would just go get burgers, whether I got the merits or not. And I didn't care. And so, I got caught and they made this huge deal out of it. And I'd been pretty behaved at that point. So anyway, it became this huge deal. Well, then Kathy Clemenson comes to me and this was it for me. They said, hey, your mother hasn't paid this month. We need you to go call her. Come up here with us. And I told them, there ain't a way in hell that I'm calling my mother to ask them for money. Like, why would I do that? And they're telling me, no, you're going to do it. I'm like, no, I'm not going to do it. I don't care what you do. I'm not telling my mom anything. So anyway, so that was it. So they didn't make me do the call. I ended up going to the dorm. But the next day, church, nope. I went through the exact same concept. It worked for me at Bethel. So I said, I'm going to do this again. I learned. And I wasn't in fear of death at Agape. I just realized, look, man, I'm 15 now. I started this at 10. I'm going to be here forever. And I don't want this. I'm not a behavior problem. I'm a behavior problem because they make me one. They bully me and I lash out. And that's why I'm a behavior problem. And I always was at Bethel and Agape. I never liked to be bullied. And I struggle with that today. I have problems dealing with law enforcement all the time, speeding tickets, just because if they talk to me, even in the slightest inkling, I go back to, I revert to that. So anyway, long-winded. I wouldn't go to school. I wouldn't go to their churches, which really makes them mad there. They're really serious at Agape about religion, right? And so they would drag me there and restrain me in the church. And so then I would just keep yelling stuff out to try and interrupt it. And I wanted to be the most disruptive as I could at Agape, because I knew that was the only way I was going to get out of here. And so, Amanda remembers when she got there, she was just as, she was young, and they had come in about 3 or 4 months. I fought them for significant months. They restrained me every day in the corner in the dining room. And so I would do these things. And eventually, Jim calls me upstairs. He goes, I'm just going to send you home. Cool. 9/11 happened. I was going to fly, but then 9/11 happened and I had to take a Greyhound bus because they had all the planes grounded. Yeah. And so anyway, yeah, I got out and I'm going to include this part and then I'll let you ask me a question, but it's important to me that I always include this part for personal reasons. But I got home and my mom's, you know, she tries to get me to foster care. My mom's wealthy. My mom's a millionaire. Mm-hmm. And she's trying to get me to foster care. She hasn't seen me since I was 10. She was giving me to foster care. So anyway, they take me down to Monroe to meet with the state and they're going to give me to foster care. My dad, who's not my dad, he's actually my first stepdad. He had adopted me when they were married. So he had to sign it over. So he's broke. My dad's poor, has nothing, barely take care of himself at the time, but he stood up and was, we're there and they're getting signed. And he just said, no, I can't do it. Kid's been through enough. I'm going to take him. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I will. So anyway, I always tell that part of the story because there's good, you know, my life's been fucked and, you know, I'm not his son, but I was a straight A student. I had no problems in school. I just needed a chance to be a freaking kid. So anyway, I'll let you follow up. I always like to include that part.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously getting out at 15, I have to imagine getting out of any situation like that, or maybe it would just be me, but I mean, I just got to imagine your first instinct is like, okay, that's behind me. Like I'm not mm-hmm. looking back. Let's move forward. But you've stepped into this incredible role of, you know, advocacy and like you're working to try to produce a documentary, you wrote a book about it. You've been appearing at these rallies, all of which I have to imagine take as much as they take a physical toll and take time and money. It's got to be an emotional toll revisiting, like even having this conversation, revisiting some of those memories. So what was it that set you in the direction of, I need to reach back and try to help people who are still being affected, as opposed to, and I don't think there's something wrong necessarily with needing to just move forward, but I mean, you've moved forward, but also reached back and tried to help people along and kind of raise the alarm on some of this stuff. So what prompted that kind of spirit of advocacy?
Yeah, it's you know, I struggled with insecurities, not ever feeling like I was worth anything. So I never felt that. And I always struggled and I always had lived my life as an adult. I needed to surround myself around people that needed me. Because I never felt that I was good enough for me. Right. And if those circumstances moved in my life, then I would go into chaos. I would make terrible decisions and do stupid things, live recklessly. And, you know, whether it's drugs or whatever. And I struggled, until I was around 30 or so. And what made me is I was in a relationship with girl and kids and they all relied on me. Well, it ended up not working. It was her kids. It ended up not working out. Well, and that had kind of brought me together where I didn't need people relied on me. So I could get myself in order and put my emotions aside and not let the depression get to me because other people relied on me. So then we separated and I'm in this spot where I was in a real dark spot where I'm like, man, where do I go? What is the point? What is the point of this? I have no family, you know, my whole, you know, and so, and that's what it struggled. And so what came about is this is my mission. My life is already toast. And you know, I was talking to survivors the other day. The reality is you can do medication, you can do counseling, but the reality is there's just some things that you can't get over. Like, and that's part of it. Like, as much as you want to try, I will carry this to my death. The, you know, and I hide it well. Nobody, you know, I have the nightmares, you know, the insecurities and those stuff that I hide. People think I'm this happy-go-lucky guy. But I learned to act when I was in Bethel. That's how we survived. But, and so I just decided, I wrote my story. Some friends told me to write my story in a journal and just to get it out. And it was huge. It was hugely healing. So that's all it was a journal for years. And then I call my mom when I would have these bad days and I called her and I want to know why did you do this to me? Right. And, the you know, my second stepdad, the rich guy, he takes the phone from my mom and it said, well, I'm the one that sent you. Why are you mad at her? And I'm like, no shit. She chose you over me. And so anyway, that made me so mad that I just decided to make my book public. And then through that, it's just been, you know, it's my healing process. I've made this my purpose. Is I honestly, and this is the truth, I honestly feel like I will never get over the darkness that I got to deal with internally that the public doesn't see. And so all I can do is try and surround myself with things that make it worth it. I've always asked myself, why? Why am I here? Why am I struggling with little bumps and hiccups that everybody has to deal with in life? Well, when you don't care, those hiccups seem like mountains. Mm-hmm. Like if you got, you know, if you got bills and you're $200 short or whatever, you know, when I was younger, that was a huge thing to me. Like, yeah. And now I have to do this struggle because what's the point? It was always like, well, who cares? Why am I even here? Right. And so this has been a huge thing for me is I don't want kids to have to feel like that and have that lifetime burden on them. And at this point, you know, I feel like it is healing me. And I didn't go into this like this. I feel like going out, I meet the greatest people. Survivors are some resilient people, and they are the nicest. And you'd think we'd all be messed up, as Agape says, you know, we're troubled. But man, it's just been really healing. And so the reason I got involved was really on accident. I'd written it as a journal. My mom made me mad and I lashed out and published the book. And it's just been fun. I would do like the media, you know, whatever media I could get back then. And people are blown away by the story. They're like, this happens today. Yes, it happens today. And no, I realized nobody knew what was going on. Nobody knew the damage. And one point that I always tell them when I'm telling them is like, look, you know, they are hidden, you know, like I left from Seattle to Mississippi and Missouri. So, you know, they're out of state, they're out of mind. But the reality is these people end up so traumatized that that some of them kill themselves. Some of them turn to drugs. I did it when I was younger. And, or crime, or, you know, they put this burden on society. We can do better by not creating this system of harming our children to where they feel like they have nothing else to live for. And in turn, you know, we can do so much better by, it's so simple. But anyway, I'll let you ask that's a long monologue.
You're leading into exactly what my question for you is, which is the question I often find myself with. And it's becoming more clear, you know, the more conversations I have, but one of the things that early on when I was first broached with this, because I knew of Agape when I started the podcast, because one of the teachers at my school growing up, he actually was a former Agape staff member. And so I had heard the PR, like he would present Agape sometimes and was like, oh, it's great, saves lives, you know, all this stuff. And so then when I connected with Amanda Householder and she was like talking about Agape, I was like, well, that doesn't even sound like what I heard about. And then she started telling me her story, you know, and then I was like, okay, well, that's pretty crazy. So there's like what, like two or three places like this? And she's like, no, there's like hundreds of places like this. And for me, that was one of those like, wow, this is crazy. But one of the things that I'm always curious about is, agreed we can do better, agreed that most of the ones that anyone that I've covered on the show, but most of these homes definitely need to be shut down. Do you think there's a place for troubled teen, quote unquote, programs or homes, or do you think it's just a flawed concept in general? Because that's an area I do think that there is, I definitely don't think it's at a large scale, but I do think there are situations in which, you know, kids do need real help. I tend to think it's more on the like mental illness and treatment side than it is the disciplinary side. But what's your kind of viewpoint? And like, as you go to these rallies and speak to the media, what do you want to be accomplished across the industry as a whole?
Yeah. So yeah, it's a great question, you know? And so yes, there are circumstances where children can't be in the home. Personally, keep your kids at home. Yeah. By any means, just the act of sending them is something that they'll always live with forever. It's, you're not worth it. You're not worth my time. And that will live with them. Forget the issues that go on there. They will suffer insecurities for the rest of their lives. If their own parents walked from them, that's a hard thing to deal with, man. And so, but there are cases where, you can't keep your kid at home, even if you wanted to. So if you have brothers or sisters, you know, we had a guy at Bethel that had some sexual deviancy going on in the home with his siblings, and he should not have been at home. He should have been
in a safe, he shouldn't have had to deal with, he shouldn't have been, you know, he was still a child, you know, so, you know, what he did, he was a child, you know, and so those things, you're only pulling him out because of the safety of, the other children in the home. And so, and the reality is, you know, you said about shutting them down. I make a point to not say that. I say, if you're going to abuse our children, then we're going to shut you down. Because I believe that we're going to win this battle. I believe that through public awareness, by doing what you're doing, by doing what we're doing, by everybody, you know, Amanda and she's got an incredible story. Everybody's got these incredible stories. People listen because it's hard not to. And so as we go, we're going to force these programs to have regulations where in oversight, we're actually enforcing the laws. And, and through that, you know, we need to have mental health people in there. We need to have phones. These children, if you were to be in a jail cell anywhere in the United States of America, there's phones for that people that have, that are sexually abused in these jail cells in anywhere. It's a federal law that the inmate can go to the places and get to a phone. You cannot do that. You can be sexually abused in these homes and not get to a law enforcement person or a third party that's not involved with Agape. And at the end of the day, so, you know, what I'd like to say is, yes, keep your kids at home. And, you know, I'm not trying to make this a us versus them by saying I want to shut them down. I feel like I'm creating this narrative. Yeah, I want you shut down if you're going to abuse children, period. If you're going to do what you've done, which most of them will, so they will be shut down. But the reality is no, what do you got to hide? We're just saying we want to check on the kids. We need this, this, and this. Do what you're going to do. And at the end of the day, and if not, then we need to come up with a whole different system. Personally, I don't care what the situation was. I'd never send my child to a program ever. I don't care what they've done. And it, you know, any with the safety issue, I would work it out to where this child's not still going to an insane route, because then it's just going to create this cycle of abuse that, you know, that child's going to end up even more messed up. And it's just going to create this ever cycle. And so that's kind of my feel on that is I've learned to tell the media and the public is, you know, one thing I always like to say is dog kennels, man. If you kick a dog and if you abuse a dog, don't feed them, you're going to jail. We have higher animal rights in this country than these programs, right? And so, I mean, we have the laws on the books, you know, and the question is, well, we're separate state and church, but separate state and church doesn't allow you to go rob a bank because that's your religion. And it's just, we're not going to kind of interfere with what you're teaching the kids. So it's, we need to get our government to be bold. At the end of the day, the laws are on the book. We're saying we want regulations because we can't get behind the doors. That, you know, Agape locks the doors to the public and then goes out to the community and says, hey, we're this pillar, but they keep their doors locked. They don't let nobody in there. And so, you know, we need to enforce laws and create further regulation and oversight, just like dog kennels or nail salons.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. No, I've said it before, but I mean, there's no religious exemption for abuse, and there's no, you know, the fact that there isn't, I just recently did an interview with a pastor discussing kind of the approach to the Triple T industry. And that's one thing he kept hitting on was, he's like, if what you're doing is right, he's like, transparency is like your best friend. Like you should desire to be as transparent as possible. And you know, for me, that's where I see I definitely don't think we need facilities at the scale that we do. I mean, they're huge money factories for people that operate them. A lot of them are, you know, so I think we don't need them at the scale we do, but I think any place that is legitimately trying to be a place of rehabilitation or whatever word you want to say, there should be utmost transparency, especially since it's involving Absolutely. Kids, and especially if they say they're religious, because I think there should be a double layer of, you know, attempt to be moral about or ethical about how you go about doing this. Moving into the next, in the next couple years, I mean, obviously, you know, there's been the huge bomb of, you know, I mean, the Paris Hilton documentary kind of brought the public awareness up, out like beyond the just survivor community or people adjacent to it, like myself, with the work that I'm doing. So you're getting hit up. I mean, there's a lot of stories being written, which is phenomenal. And the work that, you know, you've been doing with Bethel Boys, the Bethel Documentary Group, that Amanda's been doing. I mean, the fact that like TikTok has brought in so much awareness through people like Hannah and Amanda is amazing. Yeah. Miranda with the Troubled Podcast. As you look into the next year or two, like what's your goal and what do you want to see accomplished now that there is this momentum? And what can people do who are like myself, who are sitting on the essentially sitting on the sidelines going like, I didn't know this existed. I'm trying to figure this out, trying to be a part and help in whatever way I can. What's the best way to kind of mobilize from here on out?
Yeah. And, you know, it's a great question. And all, you know, I had a community member at the event. We had some people in the community that asked us that. And so, but I'll get to that in just a sec. So, I mean, I guess, you know, with all the movement, it was a two phrase question. So I'm going to do the first one first, which is, where do I see this all going? And then I'll talk about like how to get people involved. I see this, you know, I've honestly felt that the people, that's all that matters in this country. And so with this, you know, when I started this project, you know, how can I, back then there was no media, 30 years. And even when the media comes, I'm still skeptical right now. They come and then they go, And so how do we do this? And the only reason we need the media is because the public doesn't know. I'm out shaking hands in Seattle for hours back before, you know, COVID. And, you know, every day handing out flyers, getting people, call your congressman, get involved. You know, this happens, you know, mm-hmm. call your local government officials and say, hey man, this is unacceptable. What is going on up there that you guys can't do simple things to protect our kids from child abuse? That is the easiest law that should ever happen. And I said that over there, you know, the fact that you and I are sitting down right now having a discussion about separation of state and church was totally different. That's what they do when they don't have a winning argument. They change it.
Yeah.
Right. And so, it's not, we just want these kids to have their civil rights. They have the rights to not live in fear, to exercise, just like they do. Or, you know, and the fact that we're even arguing this, no, everybody in this country has the right to not be beaten or abused, period. You have the right, those personal rights. So I don't care about religion or anything else. And they're using that loophole to try and maintain their standing. Where I see this as everybody doesn't give up. You know, that's one thing about the survivor community. I think that that's really good. That's come along is, you know, even though we have a lot of different groups and a different little factions, I don't think there's any animosity. Like, you know, there's a couple people working on documentaries. There's a couple that do podcasts. It's complimentary, right? And everybody just keeps, and we keep pushing, If one of us need help, we go help. You know, that's why I go to these rallies, is I feel like it's trying to be that voice and trying to be, you know, when people show up, maybe I can give them that familiar, you know, face that makes them more comfortable, right? Or whatever. And so, and then, you know, look with the community, if these places are in your town, they represent you. You know, when you allow the people that you elect, and I'm not saying this in a vindictive or way, but I'm saying, you know, look at history. When things happen in our community, and I'm just going to use the Mormon church, for instance, they were, you know, they started out east. They got pushed to Missouri. The community said, no, we're not into that. So you can go on. And so with child abuse, we should be doing the same thing. No, we're not into that. So we're going to go ahead and do some regulation oversight. You want to open your doors and say, hey, if you're taking in somebody's life and with that their civil rights, then you got to take the steps necessary to protect it. And that's a sacrifice that has to be made. So community, get involved. If you see something, hear something, if you run away, believe them. These are the people that shop with you. These are the people that are, they're actually using you just as much as they were using us. And the reality is we're not, this is not a vindictive thing. And I'm trying to keep that way. I'm trying to say, look, you know, in Agape, and I know I'm kind of wandering a little bit, but Agape came out with their response to our thing. Yeah. And, you know, the response is, you know, they call us fame seeking liars and troubled boys. So maybe not in that order, but, and essentially, you know, there's a few times and there's more than that, but those three I know for sure off the top of my head. Liars, fame seekers, and these are troubled boys. No, we're men. We're men, and a lot of us are respectable and respected in the community. And several of them that I've talked to are well established in the community. We're not troubled. And then, but to come out like that and do the same sales pitch on the community that you're doing to our parents means that you're hiding stuff. I mean, like, why are you attacking? If it's not there, the simple answer is come on in. Come on in. We got nothing to hide. Come on in. And we absolutely think children should be taken care of. That's what their mission is. Like you were saying earlier, is if that's your mission and you're doing good and there's these questions, no, we want the kids to feel safe. We want them to have this. We want, you know, we're going to do whatever, because that's, we're doing this to help the kids, right? That's what this is about. It's not about money to them, supposedly. And so I know I'm kind of doing this long circle. I do that when I'm tired and not organized, but at the end of the day it's so simple. Demand better from our politicians and, you know, and the media. The media is just as responsible for this as our politicians' failures. You know, the media exists for the purpose of holding our government to account. There was a Government Office of Accountability report that came out 10 years ago. 10 years ago, we had hearings in Congress. 10 years ago. And this is the thing. The media always says, well, what's the news here? You guys have been out for 4 or 5 years. So what do you mean, what's the news here? Half of these people won't tell their story for 10, 15 years because they're so traumatized. Yeah. But the news is that our government holds hearings and says, all right, we're going to have the Government Office of Accountability look into it. So they do this 8-month investigation and they spend all this money and resources and they write this nice report and they say, and they detail each allegations of abuses, all the facilities that have them, what we can do to fix it. Problem solved. Silence. We still don't have a law 10 years later. Didn't follow their own report that they wanted, right? And so that's it, is hold our government officials to account and hold the media to account when that kind of stuff happens. Where's the media on that? Hey, right. What are you guys doing here? Right. And that's the job. And so yeah, I'll stop talking.
No, you're good. No. Yeah, no, I think that's a good, that's a good answer. And that's what I wanted to know. And I mean, that's kind of where I've found myself is like, you know, it's a situation where like, I don't have the connections internally. I don't have this, but you know, I think you have to utilize whatever platform you have to lend a voice and you know, allow people to share and just listen. I think that's a big thing too, is like there's so many misconceptions around this industry and around there's misconceptions around any survivor group, but especially in the troubled teen industry, just that label, you know, just like to be able to brush it off as these are troubled kids. It's, you've got to feel as an advocate the same way you did in, you know, when you're sitting in these homes and you know they're telling your parents that, oh, well, they're going to lie to you, or they're telling CPS they're going to lie to you.
No, it's the same
thing. Right. Yeah. Right. Well, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, so, and at the end of the day, it's the reality is it affects everyone. If you think it doesn't affect you, and this is a point that, you know, listen, they're going to label people however they're going to label them. It doesn't matter. The fact is it's completely irrelevant to, they can call us names and we're going to be above that and not call people names. But at the end of the day, this affects you. If you think that you don't have troubled children and you didn't go to a program that it doesn't affect you, you're wrong. And my point on that is it does affect you. Everybody here is human beings. And that's how we need to look at this, is like, we are better. We have the potential to do anything. And that's what I like about the survivor community. These are the strongest people ever. How many people have we sacrificed and ruined and that have killed themselves, that have turned to drugs because of depression? How these people are bright and we're just throwing them away. And then if you still think it doesn't affect you, you don't like crime in your community. Right. Well, these people turn to drugs and they turn to crime to support their habits sometimes. I'm not saying a lot of them, but a lot of these people end up in really bad. I made terrible decisions when I was younger because I didn't care. It does affect you. It affects your society. You're losing a great opportunity. Most of these people, I don't think I've ever met one survivor. And it blows me away because I'm kind of, some say arrogant, but these are the brightest people. And usually I'm like, you know, usually I say I'm smarter than a lot of people, but these people are brighter than me. They're the best of the best. and they're held down and we're putting these things, they could be, you know, so much more. And so I'll leave it at that, is it does affect you. It affects you on a community level, from all the way down, whether it's homelessness, crime, drugs, whatever in your community, or just having people with mental issues in your community that wouldn't otherwise have it. It affects you. And so don't think you're not touched by this, because there's that, you know, probably close to a million of us out here, you know? And so, or if not more, I don't know the exact numbers on survivors, but it affects you. So, right. And so get involved. And I don't think anybody that hears this is not going to get involved. It's just, they don't know about it. I've never heard somebody, oh, that sucks. But yeah, have a nice day.
Yeah. I think there's a lack of awareness, which I'm happy to see that kind of veil get lifted. And I hope that it's not a flash in the pan thing. And I think with the momentum, like I said, I think it's going to keep going, but Alan, it was great getting to meet you in person. And I've heard your name quite a bit in the last couple of months. So it's been good to actually get to connect.
I'm sorry for the wait. And, it's really passionate. And I appreciate you giving me the time. And, I'm obviously talking about my story is always something I've shied away from. I won't read my book again, those kind of things. I try and stay away from the trauma part of it. But at the end of the day, I'm really passionate about the change, and I think that we're so close. I appreciate you having me, and, sorry, I wasn't prepared. I'm wearing a freaking beanie. I've just been doing all day. I actually thought it was 7 or 8 that we were scheduled for, but
no, but I mean, it's all good. I mean, this is all the signs of progress right here. I mean, you're moving on it. I know from just watching from a distance, like that you've been super active. You've been at these events, like, you know, and you've been just a really consistent voice. And so, thank you for doing that. Thanks for entrusting, me and the show with your story. And, I hope that this kind of helps fuel kind of that conversation a little bit further.
Thank you for listening to the Preacher Boys podcast. If you appreciated the content on the show, please leave a review on iTunes, and don't forget to connect with us on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter with the handle @PreacherBoysDoc. Additional information can always be found on PreacherBoysDoc.com.